Good morning. Welcome to New Hope Community Church. This is a great day at New Hope. By the time the next service is over, we will have baptized 23 boys, girls, men. Welcome. It's great to have you here. If you are visiting, we're a little bit nosy. We'd love to know that you were here. Most of you, I hope, filled out a Connect card last week out of all of our regulars. Did these get in the pews this week?
No.
Are these in the pews? All right. If you didn't get a Connect card, there's one there. They're on a table out there in the foyer. Pick one up, and before you leave today, take the opportunity to fill it out. If you're visiting with us, there are guest cards that are in the pew. You can fill those out. We promise we're not going to harass you, but through the mail, send you some very important information. And if you are a guest, if you put your email on that guest card, we will add you to this list of Connect cards as well, because we want to send a free gift to everybody. We have your email, and the best way I can explain this free gift, really, we're not going to sell you anything. We're not going to try to upgrade you to something else. And it really is a gift that you can use in your home. How many of you know what Netflix is? Okay? We want to send to you Right Now Media. And it is what I call sanctified Netflix. Okay? It's got hundreds of cartoons that are Bible-based for your children, your grandchildren. There are Bible studies you can do with your family, with your spouse, with your kids, that you can do with small groups in your home. It's what our 20-plus small groups use a lot, all right, in their weekly meetings. But it's not just for small groups. It's for you personally. You can also pass it on to other friends. There's no charge for it. We pay a fee, and we can give it away. It's a wonderful thing. And so it really is very, very good. What you need is a smart TV or a computer that plugs in to a dumb TV. Okay? And then it works. Okay? And if you don't know if you have a smart TV, ask your grandkids. Okay? They will know. All right? And it will make it work. But with your email, we send, you're going to get through your email. It's going to say Right Now Media, New Hope Church, and it becomes accessible to you. And if you have any problems in figuring out how to make it work, you can call Teddy Miller. Okay? He will help you. He will. He will. He will help you figure out how it works on yours. But we would love to put that in your hands. There were about 50 of us who showed up here last night, and we played Bunko. I have never seen so many dice rolled in church in all of my life. We saw here last night, man. But we had fun. There were some big prize winners. In fact, sitting right back there, a couple I just found out have been married 46 years today. All right? Wait. And Mark Downs, where are you? Mark Downs, stand up. Found out 10 years today, all right, is when he got out of prison. You want to know if there's a reason I'm wearing my prison fellowship shirt today? I should have told him, oh yeah, I know all about you, Mark. Today, but no, I wore it because it's easy to get off and it matches my gray pants. So that's all there was to it. The only sign-up sheet that's coming around today is probably the last Sunday, all right, we may get a chance to do this. This is a chance for you to participate in a mission adventure without leaving the city limits of Fresno. Most of you are probably not going to go with us to the Ivory Coast of Africa in February for 2 weeks. What we're asking is for some of you to take a bold step outside of your comfort zone and to be willing to spend 26 hours the rescue mission. You'll spend the night in their dormitory, all right? If you are younger and able, depending on how many show up, you might sleep in a tent outside, all right? But for 24 hours, you can identify with a mission field that's inside the city limits of Fresno and Clovis, and find out how we can make a difference in a part of the world that we don't have to travel very far to. To go to Africa costs about $3,000. Go to the rescue mission, $25. Pretty cheap, huh? Pretty cheap. And you will find ways that are effective in reaching out to a part of society that we try to forget and shouldn't be forgotten. Jesus himself said, take care of the least of these, We talked about the imprisoned. We talked about the homeless. We talked about the poor. You have a chance to connect in a very important way, all right? All you need to do is put your name on there, and somebody will follow up with you with more information, and I hope several of you will do that. October the 17th, we got two events going on that day, the big shoot, all right? You can see Gene spurling about that. Is there a sign-up sheet, Gene?
No.
Well, then just show up?
Just show up.
Okay.
Watch the website for information.
Okay, watch the website. There'll be updated information, and we'd love to have you go. There's usually a good group out, and you share a wonderful time together. That day happens to be the only day that they're doing a premiere launch in town of a brand new Christian movie that's being released. Like War Room, it's in number one, all right? Good movie, really good movie. It's terrific. New one coming out called Yes.
Can you turn your microphone on?
Oh, you need to turn my mic. Nobody can hear me? Okay.
Very good. All right, here we are. All right, here we are. Woodlawn, all right, is coming out. This is a true story. This is of a football team back in the South when times were very, very turbulent, all right? Racial turbulence was going on. And an entire football team, because of the turbulence caused, all became Christians. And it's about the rest of their season and how things played out in their lives. Powerful, powerful movie, I've been told. I've seen the previews, but I haven't seen the premiere, but Fawn has and some others. And so on that Sunday, we'll have information next week. They can sign up, pay for their tickets. First Sunday of October, we'll be selling tickets, $6. And this is not a women's only event like the last two movies have been. This is a church-wide event. So we hope family, bring the kids. It's a great, great movie. We hope to sell it out that day. That would be absolutely wonderful. So pay attention to future information on that. If you have children in elementary age, bring them on Wednesday nights. They are traveling around the world. It's called Passport, and they are finding out what God is doing in all the different countries around the world, and it's doing really, really well. So they would love to have your kids be part of that group. Small groups. They meet every night of the week and sometimes during the day. I can't emphasize enough. I can't say it emphatically enough, passionately enough. If you are not in a small group, please join one. Please. It's one of the best things that you can do to build your relationship with others, but most important of all, to build your relationship with God and to be prepared for difficult times when they come up in your life. If you say, Tim, I'm already too busy, cut out something else with church, join a small group. Okay? It is that essential. Some of you are saying, Tim, I tried a small group, but it's not very good. Change groups. It's okay. You don't have to stay with the same group permanently. You don't even have to tell them you're not staying with them because it wasn't good. Just say, hey, I want to meet some other new people. That is okay. Because see, when you change groups, two things might happen. One is you might connect with a group that fits you better and it becomes really a great experience. And because you left the other group that wasn't any good, it might get good. All right, so see, we got options of how this kind of stuff can work, okay? It's just the way personalities, you know, not everybody's best friends with everybody. But you keep at it because it's good. It really is. I can't say it enough. So here's a way you can do this. We're going to be launching new groups again. We're all going to do a church-wide group study together beginning in October. And new groups are forming this week, all right? And so here's the way that's going to work. Tonight, you can show up between 6 and 7 in the bridge. It's going to be a little time of worship and some information shared and testimonies of other small groups and blessings that have come from that. So you can come and find out more about it tonight between 6 and 7, all right? And then you can show up any night of the week between 6 and 7 here at the church. Show up the night that you would like to meet. Let's say Thursday nights are your best night, then show up on Thursday night between 6 and 7, and one of two things will happen. There'll be representatives from other groups that meet on Thursday night, and they'll try to recruit you, okay? And you might get drafted, or if there's seven of you, all right, if there's seven of you, you're going to have a new group, and they're going to help you get started and get leadership for your group, okay? And so just show up at the time in which the night of the week that would be best for you. We do have some day small groups, and you can touch base with Ted, with Teddy and with Corey, and they will connect you with groups that meet in the daytime as well, all right? So that's tonight, 6 o'clock, over in the bridge, and every night this week, you can see Teddy or Corey here and get you plugged into a small group. Yes? Okay, Christmas pageant rehearsal sign-ups next week at what time? 12:30, right after the service. All right? I hope you take the opportunity to read about 1040i and all the thank yous. You all have been so generous in so many different ways. We raised $17,000 so that we can build a two-room dormitory for elementary-age kids in a village in the back brush of Ivory Coast, Africa. Lots of other things went on to make that possible. And if you were one of those who made a pledge a month ago, those pledges are good. Collecting is better, okay? So you've made the pledge. Now it's time, all right, for those to get in by the end of October. All right, so those are the updates on that. A couple of prayer requests. Please remember Mike Rude. He had some surgery a few weeks ago, created an infection. They had to go back in and do some surgery at the end of this week. So be praying for Mike as he goes through that recovery. Kelly Dillon is back in town from her two back surgeries in Stanford. She's at San Joaquin Valley Rehab. Continue to remember her in your prayers. Joni Jarbo, who I mentioned last week, Anderson, her daughter up in Oregon, was pregnant, also has cancer, concerns for both of those. The good news is, baby was born, 8 pounds, 2 ounces, 20-something and a half inches long, and Joni's really, really happy. And they are now this week going to schedule the surgery for the cancer, all right? It's a thyroid cancer issue, and they can get that scheduled. One other request I was given this morning is Glenn Mattson's niece, Jennifer. She has lupus. She is also expecting a baby. The baby is at about 3 pounds. She's in the hospital. A lot of her protein levels are very, very low. If they can't get those back up in a few days, they will take the baby early. They would love for the baby to get to 4 pounds before they do that. But anyway, please be in prayer. Her name is Jennifer, and she would appreciate that very much. Oh, yeah, aviation in action. For any of you golfers, men or women, you like to golf, we strongly recommend aviation in action. One of our own elder board members, all right, is the... He is the founder of Aviation in Action, and he helps with missions and ministries around the world through that. So if you'd like to be part of a golf team, give them a call. The information's in here. They would love to have you as part of that. We're going to have our offering and our offertory at this time. Right after the offertory, things are going to be a little different since it's Baptism Sunday. Right after the offering, we're going to preach a short sermon. They were out 15 minutes early over there. All right, so it's a short sermon. That doesn't mean you're getting out 15 minutes early. You know where you've been out for 10 years? and we're going to have our, we will do worship music while our baptism candidates head outdoors and prepare for baptism, and then we will come back in and we'll have our baptismal service and we will end, all right? So I'm going to ask our ushers to come forward as they come to wait on us with our tithes and our offering. And would you join with me as we pray? Our Father, we love you. We thank you for the life that you have provided us to share with you. Thank you that you give us joy when we're down. That, Father, you give us comfort when our hearts are sorrowful and hurting. Our Father, you give us strength when we feel like we can't go on. And you give us hope when it seems like we're in despair. Father, You promise to be everything we need as we face the challenges of this life. And you don't sugarcoat anything. You tell us there will be challenges in this world. And just because we're Christians doesn't mean those challenges will go away. And so, Father, we thank you for your sufficiency in our lives. And we trust you for the needs that we have on a daily basis. Father, what a joy it is to share in the life today here at New Hope with 23 men and women and boys and girls who are sharing in troubling the waters in our baptism. And Father, it's exciting because that means that something has already happened inside their life that brings about this very special moment. So thank you. Thank you for the privilege of sharing with you our gifts today and our tithes and our offerings, trusting you to meet our needs above and beyond our own abilities. We commit all this to you in the awesome name of Jesus Christ. Amen and amen. I want to do something. Before we jump into the message here real quick today, I want to introduce to you the seven candidates in this service that are going to be baptized. And so I'm going to call them in the name in which you will be baptized, all right, at the end of the service. And you could just stand up and wave real quick, all right? You don't have to say anything. Just stand up, wave, just folks know who you are. Polly Good, all right? Miss Polly, would you stand up? All right. Oh, terrific. Part of our regular 8 o'clock crowd most Sunday mornings, all right? She got to sleep in today, all right? Doug Reeves, all right? All right, great. Doug's new to our fellowship. He usually sits back there towards the back near a redhead. I haven't figured out why yet, but we're working on it, all right? Heidi Van Ess, all right? Heidi, one of our young ladies. I've known her since she was shorter than me, all right? I actually knew her dad, all right, a long time ago. He coached my son, all right, back in junior high. That goes back a ways. It's been a treasure. Krista Montanez, right here, all right. Krista is our prodigal daughter at New Hope, all right. It's been great fun for a couple of years having her and her husband here, and because of family living in Southern California and got a couple of grandkids that they'd like to have near their grandparents, they've moved back and have great jobs down there, but what a pleasure to come back and let me share in this moment with you, Krista. Melinda Miller, all right, Melinda, stand up, all right. She has the distinction of being married to Teddy's better-looking brother, all right. It's the twins back there, all right. Brennan Miller, all right. Brennan Miller, one of our young men. Mark gets the privilege of sharing in that baptism. He's been his camp counselor the last two summers, all right. And what a great, good stories he told me about you. No bad ones, all right. And then, dynamite in small packages. JT Best, all right. JT. JT's grown up in this church, and it's been great to watch him grow up into some faith as well. And his grandfather is here, and his grandfather is a pastor and gets the privilege of sharing his grandson's baptism. And so, exciting times, pretty exciting. What I want to do for the next about 20 minutes, all right, is to give a challenge to the seven of you who are up here, but that doesn't mean the rest of you have to close me out for the next few minutes. For some of you, this could be a life-changing moment, and hearing the challenge to them, you might be willing to accept the challenge. For some of you who thought you had accepted the challenge years ago, you might not have realized all that's involved. And as a result of today, though you don't need to receive Christ, you may decide to make some changes in the way in which you serve Christ. So I hope you'll stay plugged in with us. I want to do two things this morning. Number one, as quickly but as completely as I can, I want to make sure that you all have a clear understanding of the explanation of baptism, of what it means and why we do it. And the second thing, I want you to understand the reality of this commitment. Because it means this, the commitment should be this. All right, and they go together. So let me jump right in. If you would, turn to the book of Romans, chapter 6, all right? And we're going to read verses 1 through 14. The book of Romans, Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, Acts, and Romans. And it says this, Paul wrote these words, "What shall we say then? Shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? Certainly not. How shall we who died to sin live any longer in it? Or do you not know that as many of us as were baptized into Jesus Christ, we were baptized into his death?" That is the picture of placing you under the water. It's identifying with the death of Christ for us. "Therefore, we were buried with him through baptism into death, that just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so, now that we've been raised," you don't walk very good when you're dead, "but now that you have been raised in life, walk differently than you walked when you were in sin. For if we have been united together in the likeness of his death, certainly we shall be in the likeness of his resurrection. Knowing this, that our old life, our old man, was crucified with him, that the body of sin might be done away with, that we should no longer be slaves of sin." Sin should not be our master dictating our behavior. For he who has died has been freed from sin. Now if we die with Christ, we believe we shall live with him, knowing that Christ, having been raised from the dead, doesn't die anymore. Death no longer has dominion over him. For the death he died to sin once for all, but the life he lives to God. Likewise, you also reckon yourselves to be dead to sin, but alive to God in Jesus Christ our Lord. Therefore, with all this being true, therefore do not let sin reign in your mortal body, that means your physical body, that you should obey its lusts. Do not present your members as instruments of righteousness to sin, but present yourselves to God as being alive from dead and your members as instruments of righteousness to God. A question I get is, what in the world does Paul mean by your members? Your eyes, what do you look at? Your hands, what do you do with them? Your feet, where do they take you? There's some other members, but we won't talk about those today. Y'all figure that part out, all right? That's what he means. Use them as if you are alive to God. Verse 12, therefore, do not let sin reign in this mortal body and obey its lust. Do not present your members, verse 14. For sin shall not have dominion over you. For you're not under the law, you're under grace. You're under the love of Jesus Christ. So here's what baptism means. Baptism identifies us openly. You're doing this here in front of others. It identifies us openly with Christ, according to verses 3 and 5. It's a public identification with a private choice that we've made within our own heart, and it connects us to the sacrifice that Jesus made on the cross. When we were baptized, we express our faith in the substitutionary death. What do we mean by substitutionary? I deserved to be put on a cross, but Jesus went there for me. And he died for me on the cross. 2 Corinthians 5:21 says, he, God, made him, God the Son, who knew no sin, to become sin, so that we, who knew sin very well, we might become the righteousness of God. We are identified as becoming united with Jesus Christ. Notice Paul's words, baptized into Christ. This denotes a union that we now have with him. When a husband and a wife are united in marriage on the day of their wedding, two become one. And when we are baptized, when we are born again with Christ, symbolized by our baptism, we become two, once, now, one. Baptism identifies us with Christ as the wedding identifies the bride and the groom. So baptism identifies us with Jesus Christ. Number two, baptism shows the impact of our salvation experience. That this just wasn't getting my ticket punched so I don't go to hell, but I go to heaven. But this is a decision that makes a difference in the way in which I live. According to verses 4 and 6 and 8 that we read to you. Baptism shows the gospel message that Jesus died for our sins, rose again for our justification. He rose so that we could be justified. Romans 4:25. He was delivered for our offenses and raised again for our justification. Baptism shows that the believer has died to their old life of sin and now is prepared to walk a different life. Why? Because according to 2 Corinthians 5:17, we are now a new creation. You are a different young man than you were before you invited Jesus Christ in your life. You are now a different young lady than before you invited Jesus Christ in your life. We have a new life and all things become new. The key to living the Christian life is to let Jesus live his life through us. It's what Paul meant when he said in Galatians 2:20, I am crucified with Christ, so I'm not the one calling the shots in my life. I am crucified with Christ so that it's not I who lives, but it's Christ who lives in me and through me and from me. Baptism shows that the believer will one day live with Christ forever in heaven. When we are saved, we are guaranteed a home in heaven. Baptism not only identifies us with Christ, it not only makes an impact on our salvation experience, but it demonstrates the sufficiency of Jesus Christ. Jesus defeated death in the grave. Listen to what Revelation 1:18 says. Jesus said, I am he who lives. I once was dead, but now alive. I'm alive forevermore. Amen. And I have the keys of hell and death. You know what that means for you? He has the keys to lock you out of hell. He also has the keys to open the door and let you in. Amen. Yeah, that's right. For as much then as the children are partakers of flesh and blood, this human life, he, Christ, also likewise took part of the same, and through death he might destroy him that had the power of death. And who did he destroy by doing that? The devil. He destroyed him. Last of all, baptism is a call to commitment for the believer. As illustrated in verses 11 through 14, it's a call to commitment for us to forsake the ways of the world. We must commit ourselves to see sin as dead to us. The choice must be made not to let sinful desires have the dominion and control of our lives. Like the rest of the world, that should be an unconscionable choice. We should want our lives to be different. This is also a call of commitment to completely live for Christ. This is about Jesus is more important than our preferences. You must commit to surrender your life to serve him. Listen to what Paul wrote in Romans 12, 1 and 2. I beseech you, I beg you, I implore you, present your bodies as living sacrifices that would be holy, that would be acceptable to God, because this is your reasonable service. Don't be transformed by this world anymore, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind that you can prove from the scriptures what is good, what is acceptable, and what is the perfect will of God. Those of you who are moms sitting there and grandmoms, the choices that you make in parenting, the choices that you make in reference to your spouse, the choices you make in reference to your work life, it needs to be one that happens because you renew your mind by the study of what is in here. Before you make any decision on parenting, before you make any decision on relating to your husband, before you make any decision about your work life, God, what is it that you want to do, say, and express through me? 1 Peter 2:24 says, he whose own self bore our sins in his body on the tree, that we, being dead to sin, should now live to righteousness. That's the explanation of baptism. Now let me take just a couple of minutes on what's the reality of this commitment. Now you know what it means. What kind of commitment are you willing to make, knowing full well what this means? How many of you have ever heard this line? God loves you, and he has a wonderful plan for your life. That is true. But that's not the whole story, folks. That line by itself sounds really good. How about God loves you, has a wonderful plan for your life, and part of that wonderful plan is difficulty, pain, and suffering? How do you like that one? That's part of this commitment. That's part of what this means. This part of the message is not found in most tracts. It's not found in most best-selling books. It's not heard in most Sunday morning baptism sermons. Listen to a quote from Mark Galley. He's the managing editor of Christianity Today. He said, we've heard plenty about the God of the wonderful plan and the God of possibility thinking. Recently, we've been told a lot to follow our bliss. How many of you have any idea what I'm talking about? Oh, that's good. I'm good. I'm glad you don't. I'm not even going to tell you to Google it. Okay? It's a contemporary way of creating your own God out of your own bliss, which is another way of false worship. And in every age, there have been lots of people who follow the God who will do well by me if I do well by him. But the God who plans to make our lives difficult, and if he really loves us, the God of the Bible might make our lives really difficult. Are you ready for that kind of commitment? How many of you wondered why you who was up here? For those of you who know me well, you know I hate chocolate, so it's not because I'm drinking it. Ever since the 1920s, Yoo-hoo has been making a permanent mark in the history of soft drinks. The story starts back in the early part of the 20th century when the Oliveri family of New Jersey ran a small business producing true fruit flavors by squeezing fresh fruit. Mr. Oliveri believed that the chocolate flavor, which could be marketed without fear of spoilage, would be a very successful addition to his true fruit business. In keeping with his policy of using all natural ingredients, Olivieri did not want to introduce a chocolate drink unless he could be absolutely sure he could eliminate the spoilage problems, and he didn't want to add chemicals or preservatives. One day, he was assisting his wife in the kitchen while she was preparing to preserve her tomato sauce. The idea struck him that heat might be the method of preserving chocolate as well. That day, he prepared 6 bottles of chocolate drink, had his wife put them through the same process she used on her tomato sauce. After a period of time, 3 of the 6 spoiled. Didn't work. After further experimentation, he realized that not only did he need time and temperature, but he also needed agitation to get this to be an effective uniform product. This led him to the purchase of a rotating pressure retort, which he processed his first batch of chocolate drink that you know as Yoo-hoo. And if you drink it, what are you supposed to say? Yeah, good job. Some of you drink it. You see, life is not easy either. We just don't breathe life into the human body and say we're good to go. Life's not easy, and Jesus never promised us that it would be. There are pressures. There are times that we feel the heat. There are times when we feel really agitated. And the Bible says, during those times, when my spirit grows faint within me, God, it is you who know my way. We have a great Savior. And he knows everything there is to know about us. He knows our weaknesses. He knows our hurts. He knows our sin. He knows our pain. He knows our stress. He knows our burden and our cares. He is the perfect solution to every one of our needs. Jesus gives the greatest invitation when he says, "Come to me, all of you who are tired and weary, and I will give you rest." That is a wonderful promise he offers to us. Yet according to the Gospels, especially the Gospel of Mark, and if you want to turn there for our last few minutes, the Gospel of Mark chapter 1, verses 9 through 11. Let me read that. Verse 9, "It came to pass in those days that Jesus came from Nazareth of Galilee to do exactly what you 7 are going to do today. Jesus came to John the Baptist to be baptized. And immediately, coming up out of the water, the heavens parted and the Spirit descended on him like a dove, and a voice could be heard from heaven that says, 'You are my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased.' It is as if he could hardly wait to visit a blessing upon his son. And then something heavenly settled on him, kind of like a dove, maybe similar to the dove that Noah sent out from the ark, and it let him know that the drowned earth was going to get a fresh start. Like the Spirit who hovered over original creation as though something new, fresh, and vibrant was about to happen. On top of that, Mark says the words spoken to Jesus were personal and intimate. 'You're my son. You're the son I love. You are the son in whom I'm well pleased.'" It sounds similar to what God said on the dawn of the 7th day of creation when he said, "This is very good. This is very good." God's looking at you, 7. And he's saying the same about you. This is good. This is good. I'm pleased with the choice that you have made. Mark seems to be saying that Jesus is the beloved and God is showering blessings upon blessing upon him. His future has unimaginable possibilities. Is this not how the spiritual life begins for many of us? We're baptized into a spiritual dimension. We discover God for the first time. He becomes our personal Savior. We get excited about praying. We get excited about going to church. Why does that wear off? We get excited about singing and worshiping. Well, if our baptism into spiritual things, and like Jesus coming up out of the water, it's kind of as if heaven's ripped open for the purpose of showering blessings on us. God does seem to have this wonderful plan for us. We know without a doubt now that we are his beloved. How many have your Bibles open? Well, no, I don't want to do that because you've been reading it up there too. But most of you know that in Bibles, can you all see bold print? Can you see where it's really black print up there? Those are not part of the original Bible. We've gotten to where it makes it easy to find places. All right, like if I look right on down here, 4 fishermen are called to be disciples. That's what's there. There are breaks in the text so that we can find things more quickly, but sometimes it causes us to miss things. Just like the break that's in my Bible between verses 11 and 12. "This is my beloved son in whom I am well pleased." What's the next word in verse 12? Immediately, the Spirit that descended on him like a dove, that same Spirit now acts more like a hawk, drove him into the wilderness, and he was in the wilderness 40 days and 40 nights, tempted by Satan. He was with the wild beasts, and the angels ministered to him. Wow. He goes one moment from baptism with a gentle dove landing on his shoulder to the very next day, being in the wilderness, fasting for 40 days and 40 nights, living with wild beasts. Mark does not go into full explanation like Matthew and Luke do about this temptation. Mark keeps it short and concise. He just says sometimes right after the blessings comes the challenges. This temptation was severe. He was tested. His confidence in his Father was stretched. The Bible says that Jesus is tempted and tested in every way, just like you and me. You see, if our faith never encounters doubt, if truth never struggles with error, if good never battles with evil, how can faith know its own source of power in God? In my own journey over this last month, in the two dark nights of my soul, I would not go back and not have that experience in my life if I could. I have discovered some things about God and about where I am in my walk with God that I wouldn't swap for anything else. If I have to choose between a faith that has stared doubt in the eye and made it blink, or a naive faith that has never known the firing line of doubt, I will choose the former every single time. This new life, symbolized by baptism, it will end in perfection, but you're not at the end yet. You're in the process, and that means perfecting is taking place. Listen to the words of Jesus' own brother, raised in the same home, raised by the same earthly parents. Here's what James wrote in James 1:3. Knowing this, that the trying and the testing of your faith produces patience. Be assured and understand the trial and proving of your faith bring out endurance and steadfastness and patience. For you know, the Living Translation, for you know when your faith is tested, your endurance has a chance to grow. This word trying and testing is used only one other time in the Bible, in 1 Peter 1:7. And it tells us that we're being tested by fire, tests and purifies gold. Through your faith, it is more precious than gold. So when your faith remains strong through many trials, it will bring praise and glory and honor on the day in which Christ is revealed. It was a word used to describe coins that were pure gold and they had not been debased. And the aim of testing you, the aim of trying you, is not to destroy or afflict you, but to purge and refine you, to bring you up in Christian maturity. The purpose of our testing is to help us see whether or not our faith is real and how strong our faith is. Wives, if you want to find out how genuine the diamond is in the ring that your husband gave you, jewelers tell me there is a test that you can do. You can take a clear glass and put water in it. Drop a diamond in it. Drop one that's not a diamond in it. You'll be able to tell, they say, immediately. Because underwater, the diamond doesn't lose any of its luster and its sparkle and its glimmer. It will shine at you. A fake one will look just like water. It'll just fade away. God wants you and I to become the real thing. Near Cripple Creek, Colorado. Gold and tellurium, is that the right way to say it? Some of you scientists or biologists, tellurium, is that it? All right. Cripple Creek, Colorado, gold and tellurium occur in a mixture called tellurite ore. The refining methods of the early mining camps could not separate the tellurite from the gold. So the ore was just thrown into a scrap heap. One day, a miner mistook a lump of ore to be coal, and he tossed it into a stove in his tent. Later, while removing the ashes from the stove, he found that the bottom of his stove was lined with beads of pure gold. The heat had burned away the tellurium, leaving the gold in its purest form. The discarded ore was reworked and yielded a fortune. God wants to do the same in you. He wants to do the same in me. He refines us, not for our destruction, but for our value that He has in us. And so my question to you seven, this is a celebration day to be baptized. And I'm not telling you that tomorrow He's going to take you to the wilderness. But are you willing to walk in a committed relationship with Christ and trust Him no matter what the cost? If you're willing to do that, would you say, I will? Terrific. I'm going to ask you to follow Linda right out that door. Others who are preparing to share in this baptism, if you would follow Linda right out that door. And our worship team here in just a moment is going to come up, and they are going to lead you in some worship music until we are prepared. Now that you have heard the explanation of baptism and you've heard the reality of that commitment, there might be a need for some of you to pray. So would you join with me right now as we pray? You do some personal business with God. Father, I want to thank you for these 7 young people and adults who are prepared to walk into the waters of baptism, knowing what it means and knowing the commitment that goes along with it. Thank you for the privilege of sharing this moment. Thank you for family and friends and guests of our church who are here today for this very special occasion. And I pray this occasion might be special for some of them as well, because they may decide, I am ready for the Lord Jesus Christ to lock the gates of hell so that I can't enter it. And that can only happen if I invite Jesus Christ to come live within my life. Father, there may be some believers who have already been baptized that are here, but Father, they have still been a master. They've still been a slave to the master of sin rather than a devoted son or daughter of Jesus Christ. Thank you, Father, that they're doing business with you at this very moment as well. We trust you for this. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen.
Miss Polly Good, how long have you been attending New Hope Church?
Over 18 years.
18 years. It's a back. Wave, family, it's okay. Wave. All right.
Friends.
All right, great friends. You can wave too. It's all right. There we go. All right.
I just think it is wonderful when a church has good people in it. All right. And so, you know, she has to literally live up to her name, Polly Good. But it's better than the last guy being baptized. His last name is Best.
Oh, yeah, well, okay.
So he's got to be the best around here.
Welcome,
you just have to be good. That is good. Polly, I know your love for Jesus Christ. I'm going to ask you to turn and face over there. All right. Take your hands, if you would. Take your hands. Do this with your hands.
I don't follow directions.
That's all right. You're doing good. I just don't want to drown you when I baptize you.
Well, I don't want you to drown
okay.
either.
So when I push your hands up, just do this.
Okay?
All right. Polly, because you have invited Jesus Christ to be your Savior and Lord, because He lives within your heart, it is my privilege to share in this moment of symbolism of that truth in your life. I get to baptize you as my sister, and I do so in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Won't blow away now, all right? You're good. It's good.
I was a challenging one.
No, it's perfect. Doug, come on. Yes. Oh, yeah, I can still see it. Let me help you down, too. Just hold on here. It gets a little slippery. Perfect. All right. Let me turn and face Linda. Step closer up to the step here. And face Linda. There you go. Let's get to bend your knees. Polly had been here 18 years. Doug, you've just been coming this year. And it's been a pleasure to have you as part of our church family at New Hope. But it's even a greater privilege and a pleasure to baptize you as my brother. And I do so today in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Okay, Dad, get your camera ready. All right. I just don't want you to slip. Oh, go over to my left side. See, I told you, see, I used to know her when she was shorter than me, all right? So this is awesome. Heidi, I remember when you were just a lovely little girl, all right? And you were growing up into a wonderful young woman. And this is a very special privilege. Tell our congregation, where do you go to school?
Granite Ridge.
Granite Ridge. All right. And so what grade will you finish this year?
Seventh
grade. Awesome. Wow. Was I ever in seventh grade? That was so long ago, but what a privilege. I love it when young men and women, as young teenagers, invite Jesus Christ to be in their heart, and they want to take this step because this makes a difference in the rest of your life and the way in which you live. And I trust you will let this govern the choices and behavior in the future. So thank you, Heidi, for this privilege. Come closer to the step. There you go. Take your hand just like this. Bend your knee for me. All right. Heidi, because of you. I say bend the knee and everybody goes, really? Just slightly, guys. All right. Heidi, because you have invited Jesus Christ to be your Savior and Lord, it is now my joy and my honor to baptize you as part of God's family. You're now my sister in His family. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Photo op moment.
Krista. Down here right there. It's a little slippery. Come down. This is Krista Montanez. Krista is often very quiet. She would sit right back there about four rows from the back, and she would sit there with her husband and Corey and sometimes Teddy on that row, and it took me a while to get acquainted, but when I did, what a treasure, what a joy. Krista sent me one of the most incredible emails that I've ever gotten, telling me about her move and about what God had done in her life and her time here at New Hope, and as they were looking for a new church in Southern California, the subject of baptism would come up, and she said, I want to join the church there, but I want to be baptized here. And so that is a joy and an honor. So, Krista, you know Jesus Christ is your personal Savior? He lives in your life?
Yes.
You're ready for this moment?
Ready.
All right, step up to the steps. Put your hand just like that. All right. Krista, because of your profession of faith in Jesus Christ, you've acknowledged your need for Him as your Savior and Lord. It is my joy, it is my privilege, it is my honor to baptize you today. You are my sister in Christ. I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Bless you, my dear. Take a look up there. Get a picture. All right. All right. Had the privilege of meeting the first part of the Miller family many, many years ago. And it was great fun when Teddy and Christy got married and I got to get acquainted with other members of it. And Teddy is another one of those quiet souls on a pew for a long time. Once he got his fire lit, he's not so quiet anymore, all right? Very active. And it's been great fun to watch him bring friends and family members to come be part of New Hope. But more importantly, what's most exciting to me is that they become part of God's family. And so, Melinda, it's a joy and a privilege to share in this moment. You've invited Christ in your life. He's your Savior and Lord. And let's share in this moment together. Step right up to the step. Keep your hand just like this. Perfect. Melinda, because you have invited Jesus Christ to live in your life, to forgive you of your sin, to be your Savior and Lord, it is my privilege now to baptize you as part of God's family in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Look right up there. Hold a lot. The next two, first one's Brendan Miller, all right, Melinda's son, and his camp counselor, and one of the elders here at New Hope and Sunday school teacher, Mark Addis, is going to be baptizing him, followed by J.T. Best, who's being baptized by his grandfather. So this is Brendan Miller, who
for the last couple of years has come up to Heartland Camp, and I've watched him grow in his relationship with Christ. And I'm just excited that he wants to do this today. I see him on Wednesday nights as well. So Brennan, have you accepted Jesus Christ into your life?
Yes.
All right. So it is my privilege, because of your profession of faith and your acceptance of Jesus Christ, to be able to baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Well, it doesn't get much better for a pastor to go through life, and then his grandson a couple of months ago, my daughter Janine, it's been with the church for a long time, actually, Janine and Brandon, and Brandon, you're still my best son-in-law. My daughter called and said, JT wants to have the baptism talk. So got with him and made certain that he knew Jesus as a Savior. And what a privilege before you and this body and this family to baptize this little guy. So sit down here now, buddy. JT, you know Jesus as your Savior?
Yes.
On your profession of faith, I baptize you, my brother, in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Because you have invited Jesus Christ in your life, because he is your personal Savior, you are now my brother in God's family. And so it is my joy and privilege to baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Bless you, buddy. What a privilege. What a privilege. Come on, Miss Carol, take your time, no rush. Go really slow here, okay? Chris is going to come be on that side of you, and I'll help you with this side, all right? One step at a time. This is Carol Curry. She's just a smidgen older than AJ was. All right?
Just a smidgen. Yes.
Carol, I'm not going to ask what grade you were in this year. All right?
You want to know?
No, but here's what I do know. I'm going to mess your hair.
I know.
Will you forgive me?
Yep.
Okay. All right. Carol, it has been a pleasure to prepare knowing that you were coming here today to be able to share in this moment. How long have you been popping into New Hope?
Actually, I used to come all the time, and so I had to start using that walker.
I know. It got harder, but it's good to have you here, and it's good to share in this very special moment. Okay, if you don't mind telling them how old you are, tell them.
83.
83 years old. Being baptized. I think that's pretty awesome, huh? All right?
I think that's old, too.
I think it's incredible. We're going to be very, very careful, all right?
Okay.
So just step right up close to the step, because I don't want to bump your head.
Hold tight.
I'm gonna hold. I won't drop you. All right. Hold your hand like this. Okay. And then I'm gonna push it up. Just plug your nose. And push your hand up. Okay. Here, turn your hand around. There we go. And then when I push it up, just cover your nose.
Okay.
Okay.
Yes.
All right, Carol. Because you believe that Jesus Christ is your Savior and Lord, because He lives in your heart and He's got a home in heaven for you, because of that profession of faith, you are my sister. A slightly older sister in Jesus Christ, but my sister. I now baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Lay back.
I'm not sure who the oldest person is I've ever baptized, but Carol's going to be close. Going to be pretty dang close. All right, I'm going to have a whole family come in now as they get opportunity. I'm going to have John and Sam and Stacy. All right, well, I want all three of you to come in at once. All right. We told Carol in a visit with her that because of her walker, she called concerned, and we said, you know what, we can sprinkle you. We've done that on some other occasions with folks. She said, no, I want the whole thing. So we are so happy to take it. Come on in, guys. Come on in. Take your time coming in. I'll just let them fall. I'm going to bring it. I'm going to get you all in at once. Come on in, Samuel. Right over there and get on that step over there in front of your dad. This is the Mansfield family, and a good chunk of them are on the front row right there. All of them got their phones and cameras ready to go. All right. It has been so much fun. I've known John before he got married. I think John wasn't a whole lot older than this one was when he first started coming to church here. So this is exceptional. This is great fun. This is even more fun than playing softball together. I like this. So my question to all three of you, some of the questions I ask out there, have all of you invited Jesus Christ in your life?
Yes. Yes.
Good. Amen. So that makes this a very, very special moment. I tell you what, gentlemen, what we're going to do is ladies first, okay? Mom and wife is going to get to go first. So Stacy, I'm going to ask you to step up here a little closer. Leave me room so I don't bump you. So lay her back. She's taller than I am, I think. All right? That's all right. Stacy?
Yes.
Because you love Jesus Christ, mm-hmm. because he lives in your heart, and you've invited him to be your Savior. It is now my privilege to baptize you. I do you as my sister in faith, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Actually, you know what? I'm pulling a switch here. I'm going to do Dad next, and I'm going to leave the youngest for last. All right, John, what a privilege. I'm glad you love the Lord. I'm glad that He lives in your heart. I'm glad you're part of New Hope Church family. Thank you for the honor today. I don't baptize you as your pastor today, but I baptize you as a brother. And I do so in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. I didn't mean to mess up your hair. Sorry about that. Okay. Dad, I want you on this side of your son, Sam. Mom, I want you on this side. Okay, now come over on this side. Okay? This is going to be a joint project, okay? I'm going to ask you to put a hand on this shoulder, you to hand on this shoulder. I'm just going to help with the hands. You guys get to help baptize your son, all right? Samuel, you've told me you invited Christ in your life. He's your Savior and He's Lord. So we share this baptism today because we want the rest of the world to know that you're a Christian. So because you're a believer in Jesus Christ, I don't baptize you today as your pastor, but just as I baptized your dad, I baptize you as my brother in God's family. And I get to share in this very special moment with you, with your dad, and with your mom. So together, we baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. 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 God bless you, buddy. Thank you for the privilege. Kim, come on. Slowly. Why don't you come and sit right here, all right? This is your daughter, and then we'll get your two friends in when I get you in. But just sit right here. This is mother and daughter, all right? Kim's been coming to New Hope off and on for a lot of years, and we're glad it's on, all right, and strong right now. And so, Kim, it's a pleasure to share with you in this baptism. Is Jesus Christ the Savior and Lord of your life?
Yes. All right, then I'm going to ask you to turn and face, look right over there. Okay. Take your hands as I showed you. Kim, because of your profession of faith in Jesus Christ as your Savior and Lord, it's my privilege to baptize you as my sister in faith. I do so in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Akira, where do you go to school?
Clovis West.
Clovis West. I'm so sorry. Just kidding. Just my kids, you know, Buchanan and North, so I'm sorry. All right, but I'll get there. What grade are you in?
Ninth
grade, so you're bottom on the totem pole. But yeah. You'll end up on the top, all right? Kira, do you know Jesus Christ as your personal Savior?
Yes.
You love Him with all your heart?
Yes.
Then let's do this. Step right up to the step. Put your hand like I showed you. Akira, just as I baptized your mother as my sister in faith, I now baptize you as my sister in faith. We are part of God's family, and I do so in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Darren and Amy. Is it warm, huh? It's nice. Better than it's cold. You come sit right here. All right. Two very good friends and all kind of connected with this family. And so we're going to kind of share with them in this very special moment. Darian.
Yes.
You've invited Jesus Christ into your life?
Yes.
Do you also go to Clovis West?
Yes.
Okay, I'm so glad. And are you ready to trust Him with the rest of your life?
Yes, I am.
Perfect. Step right up close to the step. Take your hand like I showed you. Darren, because of your faith in Jesus Christ, it is my privilege, my joy, my delight to baptize you as part of God's family. I do so in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. All right. Miss Amy, I'm assuming another Clovis West product.
Yes.
All right, good. It's just getting better all the time, all right? You've invited Christ in your life?
Yes.
You're ready to trust Him with the rest of your life?
Yes.
Let's do this. Step right up to the step. Amy, because of your profession of faith in Jesus Christ as your Savior and Lord, it's my privilege to have you as part of God's family, and I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Lead the way out. You know, I'm not sure if that baptism on Kim took or not. In a Dodger shirt, I'm not sure. I should have held her under a little longer, huh? All right, Noah. Nice, huh? Yeah, everybody's saying that today. This is Noah. And I remember when Noah showed up in this world, all right? I knew his grandfather back at Hoover High School, all right? Way, way back. And then I was so excited when your dad and mom started attending here and your older brother and sister, and you weren't even thought of yet. And that was pretty exciting. In fact, your dad reminded me. How old are you?
14.
14. 13 and a half years ago, we had a baby dedication right here, and I stood right out front, right there, and I held you in my arms in between your mom and dad, and we had a prayer about how your parents would raise you and dedicate you to the love of God. And I know it thrills them as much as it thrills me that you have a heart for Jesus Christ. You just weren't given a biblical name, but you have inherited an incredible biblical inheritance. On that very same day, Samantha was dedicated. Where is Samantha? I see your mama. Where is Samantha? She's back there. All right. That very same day, both of you were dedicated to the Lord. So this is very special for me. So Noah, step up to that step. Take your hand just like that. Noah, because you have invited Jesus Christ to be your Savior and Lord, because He lives within you and you have a passion to live for Him, it is my privilege, it is my joy, it is my great delight to baptize you as my brother. I do so in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Robert Hutchin is going to come in now, and he's going to be baptizing Ariana, and then followed by that, Chris will be in to baptize Tara and Braden. All right. You
guys, it's filled with Yoo-hoo. It's, yeah, it's good.
Yoo-hoo!
Yoo-hoo! Hey, this is Ariana. I remember her from way back when she was little. I used to be your brother's discipler, your older brother's discipler. Yeah. And so I know that you have a brother and that he wasn't necessarily the easiest person to get along with, was he?
A little bit.
Yeah. You didn't know I was going to say all this stuff.
No, I didn't.
Right under the bus. That's where you're going. So, Ariana, do you remember the first time that somebody said something to you about Jesus?
I think it was around, I had this friend, and she mentioned it in elementary school, and she would always try to get me to go to this other church called North Point.
See, a friend invited her, and most of us came that way, right? We first showed up because somebody that we cared about or cared about us invited us to church, so keep doing that. And did you show up to church and get saved the very first time?
No.
No, probably not. How did that happen?
I think it was about mid-June this year.
Mid-June this year. Yeah. And so the seeds that were originally planted, it took a number of years to kind of grow, and now they're flourishing. And I think it's cool that when I look into your eyes, I see Jesus. And I think that's because of the love in your heart. And John, the book of John says that they'll know that we are Christians by our love, by the way that we treat one another. And what I love is seeing you in the youth room, because you've never met a loser. You always talk to whoever's around you, and you're not too good for anyone. And when I see you interact with people, I recognize Jesus by your love. And because you have accepted Jesus, that makes us brother and sister. And these are all your brothers and sisters too. So I challenge you that when you come to church, you look at them and say, that's my sister and that's my brother. And we don't always get along with our brothers and sisters, do we? Yeah. Just like you and Nick. And that was kind of the whole point I was trying to lead towards. You're not always going to get along with everybody out there, but your family, and they love you. And what really matters is who shows up on moving day. And these are the kind of people that do that, okay? So I'm going to ask you, well, we can do it that way. Ariana, because of your profession of Christ, because I know that he lives in your heart, and because you love him, it's my honor and privilege to baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Tara, and what grade are you in, Tara?
I'm a senior.
Senior, that's awesome. Mm-hmm. The cool thing about Tara is she came my first week here, so that's really, we have a kindred spirit there, and I'm super excited about that. So I'm just going to ask you a couple questions, because of the time. Just going to ask you a couple questions, and then we'll get into it. So Tara, do you believe that Jesus Christ is your Lord and Savior?
Yeah.
And that he makes dead things live again.
Yeah.
Awesome. Awesome. Well then, I'm excited to and honored to do this, that you get to join our family. And you are now my sister in Christ. And so, Tara, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Graydon, what grade are you in?
Seventh.
Nice, nice. You have family out there? Wave,
yeah,
wave.
Hi.
Wave.
Hi, guys.
Nice, nice. Very good. So,
hi, Mom.
I'm super excited. Every time I come and talk to Braden, he comes and he talks to me about this cool opportunity he's had at school to talk about Jesus, and this very cool things that he's doing, and this passion and this excitement that I see in you. And so I'm super excited to do this today. And I'm going to ask you the same question, Braden. Do you believe that Jesus Christ is your Lord and Savior, and that he makes dead things live again?
Yes.
Awesome. Well then, brother, welcome to the family. My brother, I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
So anyway, let them know how proud you are of them. And three of them are in here already, Linda. So we're good. This is a special day. It's a day I trust that they'll never, ever forget. There have been times in my own life where the evil one has tried to back me up, and he can't get me past the day that I was baptized. And the promises that I understood that day and the commitment I was made that day, and I wouldn't budge past that moment. So I trust this will be very, very special for them as well. Speaking of the recording, last Sunday, we did not get this, we got it recorded, and then something happened to it before it got onto the website. And so we don't have last Sunday's sermon. Several of you were out of town, said you wanted to hear it. Several of you said you couldn't be here, but you wanted to hear last Sunday's sermon. So here's what we're going to do. Next Sunday night from 6 to 7, if you missed the sermon and you want to hear it, show up next Sunday night from 6 to 7, and we're going to preach that sermon again and record it. I'd rather record it with 5 people here than have to do it in an empty room. Okay? It just doesn't work as well for me. So if you wanted to hear last Sunday's sermon and you missed it, then next Sunday night, 6 to 7, we're going to play the song Say Amen that we learned last week. All right? Tim Kepler taught us last week, a song that meant so much to Shelly and I over these last 4 weeks. We're going to play that song, and then we'll preach the message. We'll record it so you can either hear it that night, or it will be recorded the following week and then put on the website. All right, guys, have a great day. Thank you for being here. God bless you.